County House delegation meeting. Before we get started, let me see if Chair Zucker from the Senate has any. Great. So we're going to go off agenda a little bit, just for a few minutes here. It wouldn't be a Montgomery County House delegation meeting in 2020 if we didn't take a few minutes to embarrass Sarah Hartman, now former aide. So I'd just like to call up to the front here some of our former. Delegate Robinson. Former Delegate Robinson, I don't know how you like to be addressed. The Honorable Shane Robinson. And Delegate Frazier Hidalgo.
That's right. That's great.
And Sarah, you got to go up here and be embarrassed as well. Come on, you can do it. So first of all, Shane, let me warn you, we're now live streaming, so be careful what you say.
And Sarah's here, so this is
So real quick, Sarah, just let me first say that Senator Feldman really wanted to be here. I know he hired you as your first delegation chair that you worked for. He's in Florida on a family matter, so he just wanted to say, sorry, Liz, you could not be here, and how he considers it one of his best decisions in the General Assembly to have hired you, and I think we all agree. You worked with five delegation chairs, and I did some quick math last night, and something like 46 different delegates from Montgomery County during the time you were delegation administrator. So thank you so much. I'd now like to go through the years here and turn it over to Delegate Kaiser for a few words about your great work.
Oh my God, well, no one can speak about Sarah's great work more than I can, because we worked together when I chaired county affairs for 3 years, three of my 4 years back in 08, 09, and 10. And then for the 2.5 years I was delegation chair. And not surprisingly, I was looking at a plan to take her away all those years because Sarah is great at her work, great at everything. Someone who's a friend who I know is so incredibly awesome. So I apologize to the delegation. Your loss, my gain. But honestly, I've just known Sarah. I mean, we've worked together on and off for 15 years, and she's fantastic. So congratulations for all your good work for the delegation.
Thank you. Don Robin.
Hey everybody, it's a real pleasure to be here. I worked with Sarah as well. I was briefly a delegate, even more briefly a chair of the delegation for a while, for one term. And really I felt like Sarah was delegation chair because she did everything that was important. I just, you know, needed to be a semi-literate biped with a pulse. there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes to make this work. And I think grudgingly, a lot of delegations understand that this delegation has a reputation of being an efficient and fast-working delegation that puts out a quality work product. And it was always a pleasure to stand up late in session and announce on Thursdays that the Montgomery County House delegation would not be meeting on Fridays. Usually to cheers from this delegation and cheers from everybody else, but Sarah was the one that made that happen. All the meetings, the fending off of the myriad non-governmental organizations that wanted to address this body because they didn't want to make 24 meetings, so they thought they'd ask. I could not say no, but Sarah was like, just say no, you can do it. So she did everything. I was left with the smaller, meaner tasks of doing things like arranging the seating chart, providing recommendations to the speaker's office on parking spaces, offices, sometimes even desks. And it would fluster me, and I'd walk into her office wanting to pull my hair out, and she was always calm, unflappable, sometimes with a wry smile on her face, and no one smiled because she'd been through it before. And then we made a decision, and everything ran smoothly. And it's a real loss that she's leaving. Delegate Kaiser, Chairman Kaiser, is smart to have instituted this years-long plan to have her away. It's a loss for the county. It's a great benefit for the state of Maryland. And I only hope that Sarah doesn't know her own value, because someday somebody else is going to grab her, and that'll be a loss for Maryland. So I hope she's not here listening to this, because I don't want her to get another better job. We need to keep her here. So thank you, Sarah. Great pleasure to work with you.
So I had the distinct honor and pleasure to work with Sarah as vice chair of the delegation for more like 2 years, year and a half, 2 years. And then, on probably the most contentious meeting that we have had in this delegation in many, many years, and I think that Chairman Barber could probably attest to this, probably the most contentious meeting ever. Shinny decided, I got to know you, I'm not coming in, it's on you. And I didn't want to have anything to do with it, but Sarah helped me through a very contentious meeting in which I wish the state trooper was there at that meeting, so unfortunately we didn't have the state trooper here at the time. With that said, and then I ended up being chair for maybe like five or six months I was chair, which was fascinating because I pretty much did what Sarah told me to. I'm not the wisest guy in the room, but I know what I'm capable of and what I'm not, and when everything's running really, really well, that's what you do, you just kind of keep it going. With that said, I did want to mention one thing which I think is probably the most important character trait of Sarah. Everybody's talked about how efficient she is. Everybody has talked about how wonderful she is. And at the end of the day, the thing that I truly love about Sarah is that Sarah is an absolute beautiful human being. She's just a wonderful, wonderful, genuine person. And that's what I have to contribute. Thank you for everything you've done.
Plaque to go with your new job. I tried to cross out Ways and Means and write back in Montgomery County. We kept it in, so let me present that to you. And I think, Michelle, do you want to take a picture of all of us? There we go.
One, two, three, four, five.
I'm going to do the bag because it has a part in it. Thank you so much for all your help. Sarah just whispered we need to get back onto the meeting agenda after your
Just so everyone remembers, I was the first one to hire. She was my legislative aide.
Before Senator Rich hit Delegate Feldman stole it from you, is that?
No, then Montgomery County stole it.
Well, Delegate Feldman was the chair.
Well, that's right. I guess it was his fault.
Thank you, everybody, and thank you, Sarah. And we will now move on with our regular agenda. We'll start with Dr. Jack Smith, Superintendent of Montgomery County Public Schools, and Board of Education President Shebra Evans. And if you wouldn't mind using the microphone, it makes it a little bit easier for the folks watching over on live stream.
So good morning. Thank you so much for having us. We really appreciate our Montgomery County delegation. You all are our partners in education. So good to be here. Dr. Smith and I, along with our council president, Sydney Katz, and our county executive, Mark Elrich, were here yesterday speaking on House Bill 1, the Build to Learn Act of 2020. So just really appreciative of our state legislators in particular, Delegate Solomon, Delegate Acevero, Delegate Portman, Delegate Resnick, who serve on the committee, and working really hard to make sure that we bring the much needed funding to not only Montgomery County Public Schools, but across the state of Maryland. So we are here today to have a conversation. Many of you may have heard either in the media or from your constituents a topic that is being addressed in Montgomery County, and that is our district-wide county boundary analysis. So we've come here today to speak briefly on that topic, and we will welcome any questions that you all may have. I just wanted to say that we are in Montgomery County, we're taking an in-depth look at how we are utilizing school and cluster boundaries. We have 208 schools, and what we're doing is we're looking at the factors that are addressed in our policy around utilization of our school buildings, around geographic proximity, around racial, cultural, and socioeconomic diversity, as well as stability of student assignments. We just really want to make sure that we have a good feel of the current state of our schools, so as we make future decisions around boundaries, are the external consultants that is doing this work. And we'll make note on the booklets for you to refer to page 20 and 21 and then 30 and 31, where it addresses the utilization of our school. You'll be able to see throughout our county how our schools are utilized. Some are below 80%, some are being utilized from 80 to 100%. Some, of course, are over 120%. And you'll be able to take a good look at that in the booklet once you receive that. But we just wanted to make clear that when the consultants come back with that analysis in June of 2020, that it will not be an analysis that's telling us how to reassign our students. It is information to inform the board on future boundary studies. And the key to this work will be on adjacency. Many of you have probably heard the news and from your constituents, and I don't know if it's been intentional or maybe unintentionally, that we are busing students. We are not intending to bus our students across the county. We are looking at adjacent schools adjacent, and we just really want to make certain that we're being good stewards. And then when I think about the topic of diversity, people are making the assumption that if we are just diversifying our schools racially, that that will create a change. And we're talking about really being strategic and thinking about the strategies that are giving our educators in the building on how, if they are culturally proficient, how they can work with a diverse student body. We're also talking about trying to relieve the workload of our teachers and looking at diversity along the lines of socioeconomic status. We do know that if we have that, if we're being intentional about that, that it will reduce the workloads for our teachers and allow them to really be able to meet the needs of our students in our schools. And it's a high priority for the school system to make certain that we are providing that cultural proficiency training to all of our educators throughout the county. You'll also see that we are going to be looking at Ever Farms, and that will be on page 30 and 31 of the booklet that you'll receive. And that's really, Ever Farms are students who at one point who have been on free reduced price meals. We'll also be looking at it through the lens of students that are currently on free reduced price meals, as well as our ESOL students. We just really came here to have a conversation with you, to talk about the work that we're doing in Montgomery County, to be able to open it up for questions. And also in this booklet that you're gonna get, it's gonna show you where we have looked at the research. There's research that proves and shows that our kids can do well when they're in a diverse school. And you will be able to refer to that research in the appendix at the back of your book. So you'll be getting that very soon. My apologies for not having that today for you to refer as we're speaking to you, but just wanted to let our delegation know. We know that constituents contact you on a regular basis, and they ask you questions, and we always want to make sure that we keep you informed on what's going on in Montgomery County Public Schools. And with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Smith.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here this morning. I, too, want to just really sincerely with great appreciation express how exciting it was to be at the hearing yesterday down the hall talking about House Bill 1, and I know Senate Bill 1 is right there, and the Senate will be taking up this work right alongside the House. And I can express to you, as someone who spent, and many of you I sat in front of in many different hearings over my 3 years with the State Department of Education, that in every system in this state, and this will benefit every system in this state to do this work around school construction. And school construction certainly is foundational to learning, because if we were all sitting in here and it was 40 degrees, none of us would be thinking about this information. And if the windows happen to be broken, or if the buses, there are so many buses at a school that you can't actually get in there because it's so overcrowded, or they're not best. So the operation of schools and the facilities we have are foundational to learning. When that doesn't work well, schools are vastly overcrowded, or the HVAC doesn't work, or the roof leaks, that interferes every day with children in school. So it's not just about construction in places, it's about access and opportunity and real high levels of learning for every student in the state. And obviously my greatest concern is Montgomery County. So thank you, because we are crowded, as you know. And that is a great concern to me. We have gained 23,662 students this past decade. This year we gained about 2,600. A more important number is, we turned in a number of in the high 2,500s on September 30th, which is when the state collects the official enrollment each year for each school district, a growth of 2,600 October 30th. We have gained 1,100 students since October 30th. We went from 165, 250 students, to now we're at 166, 300 and some students. And that is, it makes it absolutely critical that we do everything, including this value analysis, which is the foundation for future work. We are not reassigning students based on this look at the entire county. We are going to use this as foundational for future boundary studies, which result in redistricting. And that's a critically important point. Lots of times, people are concerned about putting students on buses, and I'll just point out that the two most recent redistricting efforts that were accomplished in the fall put no new students on a bus. Walkability has to have primacy in our conversation. It should have primacy in every conversation about schools because it's good for the environment, it's good for the budget, it's good for the students' health and well-being, it's good for the neighborhood. It's just not always possible. We have a lot of students who ride a bus because they live, their families either must or chose to live some distance from a school. Or they choose to be in one of the many choice programs or admissions programs we have across the county. So lots of kids do ride long distances because their family has chosen something or because they receive very intensive, intentional special education services. But the fact is, Montgomery County's done 131 redistricting efforts since the mid-80s. Many of you, and I won't indicate anyone because it has to do with all of our ages, but I was certainly working in the school business in Washington State when this happened, remember when Montgomery County closed about 60 schools in the 80s. So there were a lot of redistricting efforts around that. And then the system stayed relatively stable for a while in its enrollment. It grew a little bit each year. And then in the 2000s, it's just exploded, especially in the last 10 to 15 years. And it continues to be, the growth continues to be an incredible challenge. It's also an incredible opportunity for the children to walk through our doors. It's a very strong school operationally and instructionally. Our students, I'd love to give you a lot of data sometime when we have more time, do so well in so many areas, not all. And it's getting to that all that we have to focus on. One of the big questions around this has been, well, what about traffic times and congestion? And as someone who's now lived in Montgomery for, it will be 4 years in April, I moved there, I understand the traffic completely, and it is pervasive and ever present. The things that we're concerned about in terms of what we can do as a school system, you all know that Kids Ride Free is the new legislation. We've been working very closely since before that legislation was passed. Now that it's passed, it will accelerate the opportunity to work closely with the county government, and both the county council and the county executive have been very receptive to seeing if we can't get more high school students on community buses and off of big yellow buses, because that is better for the high school students and it's better for the environment, the budget, and the traffic congestion. And that will require we add more community bus routes and more community bus times, but overall it will serve us well, and it's actually done in literally thousands of communities across this country where kids ride. Another thing that we do is work very closely with the State Highway Department and with the county government around safe walking zones. We teach this at every level of school, in the elementary and the middle school, about being safe pedestrians. We teach students to be careful and thoughtful about where they, and we want them to influence their families. If you all remember the campaigns of the 60s and 70s and 80s around littering, the way this country stopped being totally littered everywhere when I was a child is by teaching children in school don't litter, influence their parents. And then, so depending on your age, you remember that or you don't, but we're doing that around traffic safety, pedestrians, and those sorts of things. And then we also know that if we can balance out utilization wherever we can, because right now it ranges from 62% utilization to 201% utilization in the county. Many more schools are at or over 100 than are under 80% utilization. Right now we have 16 out of 208 school facilities that are underutilized. So there are so many different aspects of this. It doesn't reassign students right now. It gives us good reference documents for how our schools are used, what are the geographic issues, about how we can increase walkability, and how we can also, whenever the opportunity presents itself, better bring about some parity in the socioeconomic level of the students and in the racial and cultural diversity of the school. Those are all goals that we have, but it will happen one school at a time, one study at a time. So we want to share that information with you today, as well as respond to any other questions or comments that you want to share with us. But we very, very much appreciate your work and your chance to be here.
Questions, colleagues? Colleague Lopez.
Thank you guys for coming here this morning. During the summer, I went to several Iowa schools in my district, knowing the importance of the school construction funding and the need for Maryland teachers coming up, and I wanted to get a sense of what they were experiencing, and I took the administrators and took a tour of the facilities, and they showed me some of the concerns that administrators made. And one thing that consistently came up was this concept of, oh, we're on the list. Like, you acknowledged and reported that we needed to get kids and we're on the list to move here. But the list seems to be ongoing for several years. So I'm wondering, how does this list work? Is there a rubric for prioritizing the peers in these schools? Is that going to continue with this more school construction internal?
True. There are two different levels of repair. So let me talk about those for just a second to make that clear. There's the in-the-moment repair, the drinking fountain, just pouring water out all over the floor. Those get done, we track that very quickly, and they either get done in that moment of water's pouring out, or within we try to have them done within a week. The bigger repairs that I think you were hearing about are new HVA systems, new roofing, maybe replacement of energy-efficient windows, maybe new flooring. Those sorts of things have historically been done through the renovation process, and we had what was called the queue, or the list. When I arrived in the system in July of 2016, there had been about 6 or 8 months worth of work moving away from that queue to what we call the key facility indicators that look at all of those elements. And so if you go on our website, you can see each school and what those key facility indicators are now. And as our administrators become more familiar with that, our goal is to do more things for more schools across the system with the available money, as opposed to just waiting till you do a full renovation or actually a tear down and replacement. And so it is a shift, and it's been somewhat of a difficult shift for the community, because many of our community members say, well, you tore down school X and you totally replaced it, and now you're only going to renovate and upgrade our school with new HVC, new paint, new flooring. So why don't we get a brand new school? Well, we think we've turned the corner on that, and so we'll be using the key facility indicator methodology to have a much more responsive program that does what's needed at schools as quickly as possible, as opposed to making them wait to a larger renovation. It's kind of like, and just to use a simplistic example, that my kitchen is totally doesn't function, but I'm gonna wait till I can redo my whole house till I fix the kitchen. So we shifted our philosophy around that.
So under the system, a school has not had a new HVAC system in over 20 years, how long would that take?
Well, we actually look not only at the length of time, but also, and if you want to check in individual schools, and I can get Danielle to help you, or we can help you look at it, then you could see how it's rated, And if it's 20 years old, but it's working beautifully, and there's one down the road that's 14 years old, and because of the technology at the time or the engineering of that one is not working, we're going to do the 14-year one first. We're going to do what's urgent as opposed to have some sort of list of seniority. I've waited the longest, therefore I get the most. So, yeah.
Any questions?
Delegate
Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for being down here. I have a sort of specific question. Received a lot of communication from constituents about the recycling and changing over the Walter Johnson. And I guess looking at the plan that comes out, it looks like the actual turf rolls are going to be recycled through a company in Malaysia, but there doesn't seem to be anything for a significant amount of carbon rubber until. I'm just wondering if you have any. Maybe it's a good question that you can't answer, but any information on what's going to happen to the infill tire from rubber tire?
We did change our process, that is accurate, so that we're also asking in the request for proposals when people bid on work that they look at the entire process and so that we have some involvement. In terms of the chrome rubber, I'll put the staff on the spot, and if they don't know, we'll get it back to you.
I do know there's a recycling plan for all components. I don't know all the specifics in my mind right now, but we can get back to you with the specifics.
We'll send you all of that. We'll send it to everyone since everyone has a question, okay?
Thank you. Chair Barman?
Yeah, with respect to recycling turf, I'd like to have that information as well.
Absolutely.
There are going to be several bills in my standing committee on just that topic, so please send me a copy.
We will, right away.
Anyone else? Great. Well, thank you for joining us, and thanks for being here.
Thank you so much.
HB1's here.
We appreciate all of your work during this very, you know, I know what the session is like from as an observer, and I really appreciate what you do during this time and all year round.
Thank you. Let me invite the very patient Congressman David Trone to come up and speak to us. If you wouldn't mind using the mic, Congressman, it makes it a little bit easier. We are being streamed on the camera behind it.
Good morning, everybody. How you going?
Good morning.
Hey, thank you for your time. Thank you, Chairman Zucker, just left. And Mr. Corbin, Billy Corbin, thank you again for your time and having us here today. I want to give you guys just a quick update on things that I've been working on the first 1 year. So we kind of celebrating that anniversary, take a chance to look back. Also answer any questions you folks have. And we need to continue to keep thinking about ways that we can partner together. I think one of the most important things that sometimes gets missed is how we connect local, state, and federal. So I spent the last 2 days here in Annapolis trying to put out that plea. You know, how can I help work on ideas that you folks have that might be great to work on the federal level? And do we have some ideas that might be can succeed on the federal level but could work on the state level as a test, and then we make it, get it right, and then we go back on a federal level. But we've got to work in partnership, and the more we do that, I think we'll be stronger. And we've also got to work with our local delegates, our local officials too. So I try to meet with all the county commissioners, all the mayors, city councilmen, all around the district to really get involved in the details of how we can learn from what's happened locally. If we don't listen, we're never going to learn. Let's first talk about the education piece, so that just came up. I serve on the Education Labor Committee, and I'm the only congressman in Maryland serving on that committee. I asked for that committee. It was my first choice for the speaker. I think there's nothing, as you guys in this room feel, that's more important than that education piece. The key bill that we've got in there is the True Equity Act that we put in with Senator Cardin. So the True Equity Act just went in. It's $1.4 billion in matching grants. So for every $2 the states would do, there'll be a dollar on the federal side. And it's really written to mirror Kerman. So if indeed this thing over time, it's not going to pass right away, but over time if we get it through, we get it through, it's made for to work Kerwin. So all the priorities of Kerwin, which are excellent, are also priorities of this bill. So that could be a big step in the right direction. Higher Education Authorization Act is up. It's passed Education Labor Committee. It'll go through the House in the next month or so. And again, a lot of things in there that are important, like loan forgiveness for teachers, school construction. But the federal government needs to do more in education, and that more is not more unfunded mandates. It's more help to invest in our children and their children, which is how we should be thinking about education and government itself. The other piece we talked a lot about is casework. When we first came in, President Obama took us in and said, get your casework right, take care of the district. Gaithersburg is our main office, as you know. Any of your constituents are having issues, and we love to get issues that we can solve. Visa issues, immigration issues, veterans issues. Bring us those issues. We solved over 1,700 federal issues, individual problems we worked on solving this year. I think we got a great track record on that. A lot of metrics to measure it. We had 32,000 inquiries into the office this year that we responded to. So we put a 48-hour turnaround. So we tried to take, key performance indicators and treat our constituents with the respect that they deserve to get back to them timely with relevant answers. As we talked about other areas that we're focused on, as you know, the biggest area that I'm driven on is opioids and addiction. That's a freshman working group that I put together. I've got 64 freshmen congressmen working together on my team from 31 states, very bipartisan, because the only way in Washington anything's going to happen, only way, is that we have bills that are bipartisan. I've got no chance on getting to the Senate if we aren't bipartisan. So our group has put together over 25 bills now that are winding their way through energy and commerce. Every single bill is bipartisan. They're all on opioids addiction and mental health. We really stepped hard into mental health. I know that's been a priority here in Annapolis, but mental health is something that's a hidden issue all over America with depression, anxiety, trauma, and it co-occurs with addiction probably around 70% of the time. So we've got to work together on the mental health piece, and that's been a major focus for us in all of our legislation.
Congressman, I'm sorry to interrupt you. You're going to be the first person I ask not to use the mic because Baltimore County next door is hearing you loud and clear. You have a great booming voice. So.
I do, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Congressman. Sorry to interrupt.
Have to skip that mic. Often I try and skip it. The other piece is state opioid response grants. We put together a bill for 5 years on SOR grants. And the key in SOR grants is when we send the money down to Annapolis for Hogan and you guys to spend, it's 1 year at a time. That's stupid policy. We need to figure out a way to authorize 5 years out is our number. Because then when folks come with an idea for help people with addiction, help their families, those ideas aren't 1 year. They aren't one-trick ponies. They're ideas that take a couple of years to mature, a couple of years to come to fruition. So what we want to do is move SOR grants where the state has certainty that they know for 5 years that money's coming in. And so that bill, right now is, moved through the House in December, and then we think we have an excellent chance to get that through the Senate. And it's really $1.5 billion every year, $7.5 billion, which all funnels then, down to the states. Other areas in opioids is Higher Education Mental Health Act. We got 300 college presidents together and said, we have issues in our colleges all over America. So they don't have the ability right now to study what's happening with mental health in these colleges. So we're putting together a national commission to study this. Then we can write legislation to help drive funding. First, we've got to get some metrics on it. The other one is campus prevention and recovery services. Our colleges have monies allocated for alcohol, but they don't really give them the flexibility to use it for opioids and addiction. So we've got to change that. So the colleges can look at both areas together. Supporting Healthy Mothers Act. We found that with addiction, the other day I spoke to one of the delegates from another county, and he said of the 12 fatalities they had in their county for young infants coming back from the hospital, 9 of them were tied into opioids and addiction. Pure neglect, parents that were addicted, and the child paid the ultimate price. So we've got to keep looking at infant morbidity, and that's what this act does. Family Support Addiction Act, another act that talks about the family who's suffering so much around the individual. We're all trying to help the individual, but what about trying to help the family? Because the family's going through this whole trauma, and it's the first time they've ever faced an insolvable problem, addiction. Well, many of us, myself included, and others in this room, we face that, but we faced it alone. If we had government services that could say, here's where you do this, here's what you should think about for that, here's where you go. So we had some consistency and scalability. We think we could help the families as they deal with their loved ones more effectively in addiction. We've also led and secured appropriation on opioids that's passed both houses and signed by the president of $5.5 billion in total for opioids across the country. 68,000 people died last year. Let's not think we solved this problem. That's down from 70,000. I don't consider that success. I don't think any of us consider that success. We're working on with China through the Foreign Affairs Committee. Of all those deaths, 49,000 were from fentanyl. So 68, 49 were fentanyl. 100% of the fentanyl right now is coming from China. They put it all under a scheduled drug list. Lamar Alexander went there a year ago, Senator. What now we got to do is get them to actually enforce it, because no one has enforced it. They put it on the list, then they haven't done anything besides check the box. Well, checking the box isn't going to get us those 49,000 families who suffered the loss of a loved one. So we got to go and get China to say, this is important. It's the right thing to do. And they shouldn't be waging economic warfare on us through our population, what's happening to it. We got to change that. So we're looking together. We have two good pieces of legislation on that and how we can help stop that flow through the mail and also through precursor chemicals, which are now going into Mexico. So it's coming over our southwest border and it's coming in through the mail. Criminal justice. We're taking this year to be our year to plan a criminal justice Second Step Act. I worked with Senator Grassley, Senator Schumer, Hakeem Jeffries on the House side, and most things, they flow down. So we're trying to get in the weeds and put together a Second Step Act that's real criminal justice reform. What passed Congress last year was criminal justice light. That's all it was, light. It wasn't even retroactive, the things that they did. So we have so much to do on that area. Second chance hiring is part of it. You know, Governor Hogan, you know, vetoed the efforts by this body to pass ban the box for private sector. We have a bill in for nationally to ban the box. We're working with the ACLU right now how to take care of their concerns about the bill. So we work together as a team. We've also passed the federal legislation to ban the box. And we worked with Elijah Cummings on that. That's now law. So it's happened on all federal employees, applicants. The box has been banned. Occupational licensing restrictions, myriad of areas that folks are being blocked from getting a job. How are folks going to be returning citizens and be successful? 600,000 every year come out of our unjust criminal justice system. 60% a year later don't have a job. They don't have a job. Well, that's on us, because we didn't help them find a job. They want a job. They want a place to put a roof over their head. And they need transportation to that job. But we failed those folks, and we need to step up, and we've got to get this turned around. There's so much to do. We're not the world's jailer. But right now, as you know, 25% of the folks in jail in the whole world live in America. That's embarrassing. That's humiliating. And we've got to turn that around. Medical research quickly. I'm trying to drive medical research. The ROI in medical research is 8-1. So this year we got a landmark $2.6 billion increase to NIH. So we're working with Francis Collins directly, Joshua Gordon, head of NIH Mental Health, and how we can drive more dollars in to Bethesda, and from there, really around the country and around the world. Because medical research is thinking about our kids and about our children. If you think about our children and their children, we're going to make the right policy decisions. So driving medical research, $41.7 billion went to NIH this year. And we're really focused on Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's affected almost everybody in this room, I'm sure. Some level of dementia is happening with our loved ones. My dad died of Alzheimer's. We got an extra $350 million put in this year directly toward Alzheimer's. It costs America $280 billion a year. And it's going up like a hockey stick. $280 billion. So that's key. We're working with Senator Roy Blunt, Republican on the Senate side, and it's a partnership, it's bipartisan, and we're driving it. At the end of the day, we're working to focus on those that are more vulnerable. We're going to bring into government compassion. You don't have a government that's compassionate for those that are suffering. That's not who we are. And we're working hard to bring civility also. And we've got to get civility back in Washington. And we've got to work on competence, where we set the goals, know where it's going to make a real difference, and then have the competence to get there day by day. So we'd like to get any input questions you folks have in ways. No power, nothing. But we can come down and amplify it, because if we can help get stuff done on mental health, criminal justice, NIH spending, opioids throughout Maryland, I can take that and I can run with it across the country. So I appreciate your time today. Mark, any questions?
Thank you, Chairman Barrett.
Thank you, Congressman. I just want to let you know that on Tuesday, we're having a briefing in the Environment and Transportation Committee on transportation, and specifically, we're going to have a presentation from the group that is proposing a monorail from Frederick to the Shady Grove Metro. I'm letting you know that because maybe you might want to have somebody from your office sit in for that. Personally, I don't think that this has ever been taken seriously. It's my hope to build a consensus around this kind of solution. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I totally agree. We can take a hard look at that. We've already got that on the agenda. It's absolutely crucial. And look at other ways. I mean, we can't just build roads. We need to figure out how to have mass transit. I mean, look at what's happened in Europe, Japan. I mean, we missed the boat, and we need to keep looking at innovative ideas out of the box.
Great. If you could send somebody there if it's possible,
that's
I
done.
Think that would be terrific.
Dawn Carlson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you, Congressman, for being here. I really appreciate your focus on medical research. So I have a very specific request. One of the disorders that we are seeing here in Maryland, and the incidence is growing, is something called PANDAS. And it affects young children. And it is just an incredibly awful disease that literally destroys the life of the child and the family. And it's what's happened, and what we have been trying to do is to find a way, first of all, to work with insurance carriers to cover the kinds of unique kinds of treatments for these young, for the young children. That's, and we've got some success with that in Maryland, but I think nationally that's a problem. But mostly what we've learned is there's no research or very little research on this. It's one of those diseases that some doctors don't believe exists, and others and hospitals don't want to treat it because it's so it's somewhat unpredictable, and the treatments are really very high level and very aggressive, and at some point very risky for the children. So, and don't always work. There are very few doctors who have any specialty in it. So what we were told by a specialist from Hopkins is that we need to figure out, as a country, how to get research done on pandas. And he mentioned there used to be some at NIH, but that has ended. So, I mean, you talked about the dollars going there. If there's a way to focus some of those dollars, I know we'd greatly appreciate it.
So I think that's fantastic. If you can get our office any information you've got about that, I'll get it in front of Francis Collins at NIH. That's for sure. He's the guy. But the problem with NIH is they're funding 19% of their requests that come in. They believe they could fund 35% and still have an 8-to-1 return on the investment for the American people. So 19 should be 35. That's why we've got to drive the NIH funding up. And they've got 7,000 orphan diseases, like what you spoke about, that they know right now they can fix the DNA coding. With all the gene sequencing data we have now in technology, we can fix those diseases. And we can fix them in 3 years, or we can fix them in 15 years. So it's just about the money. And the more we can drive in there, the sooner we can fix, and we can get it done. It's all right now within our grasp. And that's why this is so imperative, and we're just driven and focused on this. And again, these small diseases get lost, but they're devastating. So I really appreciate that.
I will do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Delegate Chakridian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Congressman, for being here. I am just wrapping my head around the announcement of the Attorney General's announcement of the establishment of the Presidential Commission on Law Enforcement and the Administration of Justice, and concerned that there was a lot of work done under the Obama administration that kind of laid out a framework, even though it didn't necessarily go far enough, and we have a lot further to go on accountability and community policing. And it looks like this is sort of setting up a framework of a country that moves in the opposite direction and for more aggressive policing across the country. And I'm wondering if this is on your radar. I'm still wrapping my head around if there's an appropriate role for, obviously we do a lot of state level policy making around policing, but this sort of just came across my radar, and I'm wondering if it's on your radar and what your thoughts are about ways to weigh in as federal lawmakers on this potentially problematic issue.
It's definitely not on our radar, so if you could send that over, I'd love to get that information and we can dig into it. But we've got to figure out ways to have, you know, policing that's fair, that's not oppressive, doesn't single people out. You know, I worked at the American Civil Liberties Union for over 20 years. I mean, we established the Truman Center for Criminal Justice in New York City. That's their wing for criminal justice. So that's right in my wheelhouse, and that's something I'd love to take a look at and dig in with my friends up in New York. Thank you.
Delegate Acevedo, I think this has to be the last question because I know the Congressman has another delegation to go to. So, Delegate Acevedo.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Congressman, for being here. I appreciate your interest and advocacy around education and criminal justice. I just wanted to make one plug that we are looking at, really something that I'm working on here around universal school meals. As we're talking about our school system in Kerwin, and the work that you're doing, what you're saying is consistent with what it is that we're attempting to do here in Maryland with the Kerwin recommendations. I want to make sure that you are aware of universal school meals bill that was introduced. I don't know if you saw two businesses in Montgomery County, in essence, paid a total of $60,000 to our Dine with Dignity program, which didn't cover it all, but it was very admirable and exemplary. But the fact that we have something called student lunch debt when we're discussing buildings and instructions and everything related to our schools, but nothing about when our kids are in schools, whether they're being nourished both mentally as well as physically. So I think any assistance and advocacy on the federal level will complement the work that we're trying to do at the state level to ensure that every single one of our kids have access to like free nutritious meals once they walk into the doors of those schools. And the second thing I wanted to point out was I think when we talk about criminal justice reform, we often forget that the first point of contact for the criminal justice system are police. And there's a lot of work that we need to do around police reform, particularly considering that we have like, the White House Task Force on 21st Century Policing that put out a number of recommendations about what needs to be done at the federal and at the state level, but particularly around the federal level, something that you could do around the militarization of police, right? And the kind of federal funding that goes to police departments and how our police have now become basically soldiers that look like they're policing somewhere in Fallujah or Baghdad, right? That's a huge problem. But also around reforms and accountability so that community has a greater say and oversight on how policing is administered in those communities. So I would just ask that you look at the policing point because the first point of contact is not a parole person, it's not the judge, it's not the correctional officer, it's not the parole board, it's the police officer, right? And there's a lot of issues around that. And so if we're talking criminal justice reform, you could be a little bit more holistic and start with police reform.
I think you're absolutely, Gabe, 100% right. Police reform is crucial, and we need to be part of the community, you know, not a military, you know, force. You know, it's nuts. I mean, that's just never going to work, never. So we're totally in sync on that. And what they're doing with school lunches, it's just abhorrent. I mean, they've taken hundreds of thousands of kids off school lunches. You know, schools where everybody got the lunch because of the thresholds, let everybody get the lunch anonymously. So nobody was singled out. So, I mean, that's just so, it's just not who we should be, it's not who we are. So that work is unbelievable. We spent a lot of time on this in the education, our Education Labor Committee. We did a whole summer meals tour on this. We went all through the district and talked about what happened in the summer for these young folks can't get their meals. You know, 1 in 6 is all that really gets their meals now. And then we serve lunches, etc. So this is a big deal. And if our kids aren't fed with any chance of having them learn, because at the end of the day, it's all going right back to how we get pre-K everywhere, when we attack the 2s and 3s, 2 and 3 year olds, and build from the ground up. That's the solution to all the criminal justice issues, is give people a chance. You know, a chance for a real education and meals, you know, that's crucial. So thank you for that question.
Congressman, thank you. Please say hi to our friends in the Frederick County delegation. Thanks for joining us for a few minutes this morning.
Send your regards.
Colleagues will now turn to our committee reports.
Mr.
Park.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The bill that came out of the Metro Washington Area Committee was PGMC 103-20, WSSC Discrimination Prohibited. That bill adds a couple of categories for the anti-discrimination protections for WSSC employees and for their contractors. There is an amendment that defines genetic information by referring to an existing definition in state law. It also replaces presence of children with what is the term? Family responsibilities, thank you, and defines that term. It came out unanimous as amended, so I would move the amendment.
Second. I move the amendment. Delegate Kaiser seconds. All the amendments signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? The amendment is adopted.
Move the bill as amended.
Delegate Kaiser moves the bill. Delegate Leakey seconds. Any discussion? All in favor of the bill as amended signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Great. The CAR Act passes.
The delegates card. We'll now turn to Chair Wilkins.
All right, MC 7-20, agricultural land transfer tax alteration. The committee ruled unanimously favorable with amendment on this bill. I'd like to first adopt the amendment as it fixes an error in the bill so the bill achieves its intended purpose. So I'd like to move the amendment.
Mr. Wilkins moves the amendment. Delegate Gilchrist seconds. Is there any discussion? Okay, all those in favor of the amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? No ag landowners yet?
Okay. So I'd like to move the amendment. So as amended, MC720, it does two things. It ensures that the revenue that we collect from the Montgomery County Agricultural Land Transfer Tax, that it be dedicated to ag preservation that supports preservation programs in the county. And it also fixes an oversight last year when the state made a change around the agricultural tax. The appropriate change was not taken for the county level. So this bill makes sure that the county is able to achieve the maximum tax revenue when it comes to the agricultural tax. So I move the bill as amended.
Delegate Wilkins moves the bill. Delegate Lucci second. Is there any discussion? Okay. All those in favor of the bill as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Okay. It passes. And now I'll turn to, I believe, Delegate Xi is carrying the Economic Development Committee report.
Good morning, colleagues, and a happy Lunar New Year, which starts tomorrow. The subcommittee on Economic Development yesterday voted to approve MC1320, which essentially would improve, would change the town of Kensington's alcohol laws to be more like a Montgomery County. And essentially what this bill would do is to increase the number of licenses permitted and to alter the requirements for certain licenses and also to expand the hours of operations for the permit holders. So I don't know if I should start with the amendments or just come back.
I want to adopt amendments
included in the package. I need to go through all of the 3% changes, but if you need to have that, they basically just cleaned up some languages. So I would like to include the amendment.
Delegate Xi moves the amendment. Delegate Lucci seconds. Is there any discussion? Okay, all those in favor of the amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the amendment carries. Delegate Xi moves the bill as amended. Delegate Solomon seconds. Is there any discussion? Okay, all those in favor of the bill as amended signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? The bill passes. I think that's it for our committee reports. Colleagues, just a reminder, next week after delegation at 10:45, we'll have our delegation photo along with the Senate over on the steps inside the Capitol, so just be ready to walk over there after delegation. And with that, we'll go to the committee announcements. Delegate Wilkins.
The Land Use Committee will meet on Tuesday immediately after session, and we have two bills that we'll be discussing.
Delegate Queen.
The Education, Election, and Housing Committee meets today at noon to discuss the Board of Education
Delegate Carr. The Metropolitan Washington Area Committee will not meet on Monday. We are done with our bills that originated in Montgomery County, and you might get some from Prince George's County. We finished in record time. I credit the staff for that.
So if we get into Prince George's County, can we just deem them late?
The economic,
all those
you can make that motion. The Economic Development Committee will meet Thursday at 9 a.m. in room 218. Are there any other announcements? Delegate Solomon.
I just want to say thank you to everybody who put in their recommendations for our case of Montgomery. If you have not yet, please send them to our office. We're going to be sending them over to the review and support committee that's going to be making the decision. It's not our office that's going to be making the decision. It's a group of folks from Visit Montgomery, the Chamber of Commerce, the Food Council, and some other wide and dear folks who are helping us. So thank you to everybody who's been there.
Anybody else? Just a reminder that we're going to be starting on time in the future. We did a little leeway today, but I'm going to the Speaker of the House standard of the time the meeting is called for is when we're going to start. And you should be blocking out this time between 9 and 10:50 every Friday for delegation. And if you get out early or come in late, that's great. But this is the time assigned by the Speaker of the House for our House delegation meeting. So appreciate you all participating and being here. And enjoy the rest of your morning. Is it all right with Bradford if I gavel out? Thank you all.